families getting ready to come in, and when they do, we'll stand. Well, on behalf of the family, let me thank you for making the effort to be here today to honor the lives of Ira Stewart. I'm sure it means a lot to the family for all of you all to be here. And we do want to call upon the name of our God for his blessings upon this occasion in this service. And so I want to begin. I'm just going to read a couple of short passages of Scripture, but the first one is from Deuteronomy chapter 32. It says, "Give ear, O heavens, and let me speak, and let the earth hear the words of my mouth. Let my teaching drop as the rain, and my speech distill as the dew, as the droplets on the fresh grass, and as the showers on the herb. For I proclaim the name of the Lord, and ascribe greatness to our God. The rock, his work is perfect, for all his ways are just, a God of faithfulness and without injustice, righteousness and upright is he. And then one from the Psalm 61, the first two verses, says this, Hear my cry, O God, give heed to my prayer. From the end of the earth I call to you when my heart is faint, and lead me to the rock that is higher than I. And let's pray again. Our Father, we would ask for your blessings and your smiles upon this occasion. And Lord, that even in the midst of tears, that we might feel your comfort and your truth. In Christ's name, I pray. Amen. Well, Ira Jean Hotshot Stewart of the Village, Oklahoma, entered into eternal rest on September 1st, 2023. Ira was born on January 29, 1937, to parents Henry Alton Stewart and Gracie Alticia Stanley Stewart in Springer, Oklahoma. Ira enlisted in the United States Army as soon as he could, eager to serve his country. He served in Korea, Germany, and Vietnam before his retirement in 1974. During his time overseas, Ira received several medals for his bravery and support of our country. His proudest moment was when he earned the Silver Star and Bronze Star Medal for his meritorious achievement in ground operations against hostile forces in 1970. He rose in ranks through his 20 years of service to Sergeant First Class. After Ira retired from the military, he spent most days working at his church home. He was also a current member of the American Legion, post 0135. Ira fell in love and married Ingrid Smith in 1958. The couple settled in Oklahoma and started with their family of four. Ira was a loving father to Gary and Lloyd. They both looked up to him as a good role model. Ira loved country western music and was spending time with loved ones. His perfect day would be watching NASCAR races with his whole family, spending the day laughing, surrounded by love. Ira taught his children and grandchildren the importance of honor, respect, and taking care of the ones you love. Ira was preceded in life and death by parents Henry and Gracie Stewart and wife Ingrid Schmidt. To cherish his life and legacy, Ira leaves behind sons Gary Stewart of Oklahoma City and Lloyd Stewart, wife Penny of the Village, siblings Finis Stewart of Oklahoma City, Marquita Stewart of Oklahoma City, Joe Stewart of St. Paul, Minnesota, Barbara Holder of Houston, Texas, Paul Stewart of Frisco, Texas, and Bernice Ellis of Ardmore, Oklahoma. Six grandchildren, 13 great-grandchildren, 2 great-great-grandchildren, as well as several nieces and nephews. And the family has picked some songs, and so we're going to hear the first of those.
Sweating in the sun, felt hands were steady. My eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose. My steps were quick and light. And I had fun. What I felt was right. Comes calling the ghost.
you may think that I look a little bit like Hot Shot. My name is Paul Stewart, and I'm the youngest brother of Ira. And the only time I'll use Ira today is right now, because to me, all of my life, he was Hot Shot. That's what the entire family called him for all of life, because if anybody said Ira, we thought they were talking about Granddad Stanley, not Hot Shot. But all of us are gathered here today to pay tribute to a life that was long-lived and it was a life that was lived well. Hot Shot's adult life was built around the military. He was what we commonly call a lifer. He and I would exchange war stories occasionally, like he would with any vet. And since his life was dedicated to the military, I looked back and picked out three words that were used by a famous general giving a speech at West Point many, many decades ago. Those three words were duty, honor, and country. And I'm going to take country first and describe what it meant to me to observe my brother serving his country. You see, Hot Shot entered the Army at the earliest possible age. He did his basic training here in the United States. After a short period in the United States, after basic and advanced training, his first overseas duty, and we call overseas anything that you serve this country outside the continental United States. His first deployment was to South Korea. He served a full tour in South Korea. After he returned from Korea, he was stationed again at a different post in the United States. I couldn't put together exact posts, exact dates, because there was just absolutely too many of them. But his next deployment, back overseas, was to Berlin. Now, stationed in Berlin when he was there, it was commonly called behind the Iron Curtain. Berlin was a divided city with a wall. There was East Berlin and West Berlin. The American forces were there in the free sector of what they called Free Berlin. And that's where he met the love of his life, Ingrid. They were married there in Berlin. And he finished his full tour in Germany. And then he returned to Fort Hood, Texas, and they started a family. That was my first visit to meet Ingrid, Gary, and Lloyd. And I tried to tell Gary and Lloyd a little earlier outside, but I said, the first time I met you, don't you remember it? Because you were in diapers. And after a short period there at Fort Hood, he was deployed again. And he went overseas this time, but not to a peaceful area, but his first tour in Vietnam. He served a full tour in Vietnam. And when he came back, I'd try to swap some more stories with him, you know. And I'd say, well, Bub, to serve one tour in Vietnam and to come home alive, you are very, very fortunate. Well, he served out that tour, and then they were transferred to Fort Bliss, Texas, out in El Paso. And in El Paso, a tragedy struck the family. Ingrid became very ill, and the good Lord called her home. Shortly after Ingrid passed, he was deployed again. The second tour in Vietnam. He went back the second tour and survived. When he got back, the only thing I could tell him But the good Lord sure looks out after you. Because when you serve two tours in Vietnam and you come home a survivor, the good Lord has looked out after you. Well, he spent some time in the United States. And then something very unique happened. He went back to Vietnam for the third time. Just unbelievable to be a survivor of three trips to Vietnam. Well, in service to our country, remember I said that first word I was going to use to describe my job was country. Well, to his country and to all of us sitting here today, he should be called a hero. Now, he got a lot of medals. But to me, the designation of hero doesn't come lightly. I've only known less than a half dozen people in my lifetime that I'd call a true hero. My older brother was one of them. Now I'll move on to the second word, honor. 30 years I've observed that Hotshot followed what is outlined in the Ten Commandments in the Bible. And I'll use one of the Ten Commandments. It's got the word honor in it and how it related to our family. That commandment is honor your father and your mother. I've got a note here. It says it's on page 122 of my Bible. You don't have to look it up right now, but you can later. It was the fifth commandment. He abided by all of them. But honoring your mother and your father was close to him and is close to me. And while he was in South Korea back in the 1950s, when he returned from Korea, he gave my mother a small gold ring. And she wore it the rest of her life. Well, when mother died, Hotshot had a family place and a plot where he's already got his headstone set up. That's where my mother was buried. Next, my father. Next, my sister. Then a nephew. All of those spaces were family plot provided by Hotshot. He definitely had love and respect for the family and provided for them. And I've observed through the years that Gary and Lord had that same respect and outlook for their father. And that makes me grateful. So from the above information, remember I said there was three words, country, honor, and duty. The first word that I used there was country and said that Hotshot was a hero for our country. Well, the second word, honor, I feel like for what he's done for the family, he deserves the word hero placed next to that. So he's a hero for our country. He's a hero for honoring our family. And now I'm going to come to the third word, and it's called duty. In the military, it's a common practice to have to train your replacements before you can move up through the ranks. Well, evidently, he did pretty good because he started out as an E1 and wound up above an E7. So that speaks for itself. But I'd like to tell you some of the things close that doesn't exactly relate to the military. You see, when I was in grade school, back in the early 1950s, Hotshot was up in junior high. I think they call it middle school now, I'm not sure, but the grade levels. There was about 6-7 years difference, so if I was in the third grade, he was either in eighth or the ninth, somewhere right along in there, I can't remember. But we heard rumors down at the grade school about wrestling that went on in junior high. And we heard that a guy named Hotshot was a top wrestler in junior high. Say, Gary Larker, I didn't know that. But Hotshot was an extremely good wrestler. So what did we do there in grade school? There was about 8 or 10 of us boys that after class every day would go across the street and wrestle. Well, out of the 8 or 10 boys, I was probably the lousiest wrestler in the whole group. I was kind of on the bottom rung. And every day I'd say, well, if you pin me down today, I'm going to go home and tell my big brother. That didn't scare any of them. They still pinned me down for about a week. Well, I did go home one day and I told my big brother, Hotshot, about wrestling and how they pinned me down. I said, I want you to help me. Well, we lived in Ardmore there, what's called the old Watterson place, and right behind it was a big old cow pasture. And he said, well, come on, I can show you some things about wrestling. Well, we went out there in that cow pasture. Of course, back in those days, you'd have to take your shirts off. And we wrestled around for a little while, and he said, when they're about to pin you down, he said, you just flip up and you give them something called scissors. Now, I had no idea what scissors was. And I told him, I said, well, I don't know what you're talking about, the scissors. He says, I'll show you. He locked his legs around my neck and rolled me over this way, and I'd holler and holler, and he'd roll me back over the other way, and I'd holler and I'd holler. And I tried to get him to stop. He wouldn't do it. He kept rolling me over and rolling me over. Mother came out, heard all the hollering, and she made it stop. And she says, well, what are you hollering about? I said, well, every time I roll over, there's a cucklebur bush there. And that's why I was hollering. But the next day I went back to school, and sure enough, I tried that scissor stuff. I wasn't on the bottom anymore, but I wasn't on the top, but I was probably right about the middle. It sure did help me. So from that day forward, my big brother was a hero to me and remained that way all my life. Now, in summary, if you remember, I opened with duty, honor, and country. But now, after each one of those words, I've added the word hero. Today, today, with those three words of hero, I'm going to come to the end of that military speech. By the way, that speech was made by Douglas MacArthur to the West Point class. But he closed by saying this, old soldiers never die, they just fade away. Well, today is what I call Resurrection Day, because the gates of heaven are going to open up and take in one more hero. All of us here today may possibly need to feel a little bit of comfort on a day like this. And when I need comfort, I always open my Bible and I turn to the 23rd Psalm. And it says, the Lord is my shepherd. A shepherd is somebody that will watch after you 24 hours a day and meet every need. If you look to the Lord, he will do that. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. That means that you've heard people say grass is always greener on the other side of the fence. Well, when you know the Lord, you don't have to crawl through the fence. He leads me beside the quiet waters. That simply means that in your heart you feel comfort, there's no turbulence, everything is quiet and calm. He restores my soul, he guides me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Hot Chop made my cup overflow throughout my life. And I'd just like to say that God, as we go through this day, be with us, have your presence felt, go with us throughout the day, guide and direct us, and forgive us wherever we might fail you. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Songs that the family picked to honor him At least tell me a little bit about it. They chose Like a Rock by Bob Seger and Knocking on Heaven's Door by Dylan, even though I'll have to say I'm a little more partial to the Guns N' Roses edition myself, though I'm not taking away from Dylan. But those songs do tell me a little bit about him and how you, his family, saw him. I take it that you viewed Ira as a man's man. That he was like a rock. Ira was a military man who served his country, as his brother said, in Korea and Germany, and three tours in Vietnam, the recipient of a silver and bronze star. But he not only served his country, the testimony from his family is that he served all as well. His sons saying he left us a good legacy, being a good role model for us. But though Ira was a rock of a man, yet he met man's common end. As the scripture says, it's appointed unto man that wants to die. And so another song was picked, Knocking on Heaven's Door, with the lyric, "My mama put my guns in the ground, because I can't shoot them anymore." With affection and honor, you always called him Hotshot. Maybe he was a marksman. I noticed he donned the blue cord of the infantry. But gotta put my guns in the ground because I can't shoot them anymore. What do I, as a gospel minister, tell you, a grieving family, in this time of death? Well, I just want to leave you with this, that there is one who is the rock. Not just a rock, but Jesus Christ is the rock. He is the rock of ages, and he is the only one who actually conquered sin and conquered death, our great enemy that we all bow before. And you know that he is the only one who can get anyone through heaven's door. Now, as I've already mentioned, I didn't know our personally, but I'll have to say that I can have a good guess of his general story. Because in some way, his story is the story of humanity. Ira, I guarantee it, was made in the image of God. And being someone who was made in the very image of God, he demonstrated vestiges of that image during his lifetime that you, his family, and friends observed. He was made by a creator, and so Ira was created. He was a painter who brought beauty to every little corner of his world. The family tells me that he was humorous, and you know that we can just look around at a lot of us, and we can see that the one who made us has to be humorous. You know, Psalm 2, verse 4 says that he who sits enthroned in heaven shall laugh. And our God is the one who made laughter. And Ira in it of that. But not only laughter, you know that our God is also called a warrior. He's the man of war from Exodus chapter 15 and verse 3. And so Hotshot too was a warrior. In some small way, reflecting the image of the one who made him. I'm also told that not only was he a warrior, but he was a giver. A very generous person. In fact, any of you told me that he would just give. There was just something about him. Well, where did he get that quality of give? Well, the scripture says that every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of heavenly lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. You know, God is, he's the greatest giver. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And you know, the glory and the wonder of the gospel is the gift that the Father gave. That God the Father gave God the Son. And God the Son was made just like us. I mean, amazing that God would become flesh. That God would become a man. But the God-man, Jesus Christ, was different than all of us. Because all of us are images of God. But we're all broken images of God. We all poorly reflect our Creator. We have little snippets here and there. Ira had it here and there. We have it. But it's just a little bit. And that's what it means to be a snippet. You know, perfectly reflect our Creator. But Jesus Christ is the image of the invisible God. He perfectly reflected his Father. Now I take it that Ira was a good shot. He was hot shot. But I guarantee he didn't make every shot. No marksman does. A hot shot like all of us have fallen short of the glory of God. We have all missed the mark. But the glory of the gospel is that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, never missed a shot. We all missed the mark. But Jesus, when he became a man, he was tempted in all ways that we are, yet without sin. He never missed the mark. And you know, missing the mark is why we all die. It's why we have funerals, it's why there's cemeteries, it's why there's a casket. Sin is the only reason we die. And you know what? We weren't made to die. It's something that's, it's unnatural. We know it. We feel it. There's something wrong with the issue of death. But the wages of sin is indeed death. Our rebellion against our Creator invited death into our existence. But our great God did not leave us in a state of sin and death. He sent his one and only Son as a substitute for sinners. That Christ came to die in the place of sinners, though he did not deserve death. The scripture I read just a bit ago in John 3:14, he was talking to a religious dude, and he just says, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. He made reference to a historical account where God sent snakes among the people of God because they had sinned against God. The snakes were biting them. They were suffering sickness and in death. And God tells Moses, make a bronze snake. Stick it on a pole. Put it up in the camp. And if you're bit and you look, you will live. It's an interesting thing. Just look at it. And what's been lifted up there in the camp. Kind of interesting, you know, that the snake on the pole is the symbol today in our medical field of those that deal with our sicknesses. And Jesus is the one who was lifted up. He says he's the Son of Man. He is the man. That just as the snake was lifted in the wilderness, even so the Son of Man would be lifted up. And when he was lifted up on a cross to die, he says that if you look, then you can live. In verse 15, it says, "For whoever believes in him will have everlasting life." The only hope and comfort in a time of death is that there is one who died for us that gives us hope beyond the grave. That Christ died for sinners so sinners could live forever. That God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. To have faith, to have a belief, and to trust in Christ is, that's a knocking on heaven's door. And you know, he gives us a promise that if you knock, it will be open. And Christ says that he is the door. He says, "All that the Father gives to me, they'll come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will not cast out." And so then the only comfort and hope I can give to a grieving family is in the only person who conquered our greatest enemy, sin and death. So we believe in Christ's life, and we believe in his death, and we believe in his glorious resurrection. And I hope you trust in that today, to have hope beyond the grave. Christ is the rock. Rock of ages cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. And he is the only one who can get anyone through heaven's door. The Lord bless you, and the Lord keep you. And may the Lord cause his face to shine upon you. And may the Lord be gracious to you. And now we'll watch a video montage of his life and pictures.
black dress on.
The guy was tall, black.
Thank you.